Good morning, everyone, and good afternoon to all the rest of us like me out here in the East. I'm coming to you today from sunny Maine. Welcome, welcome to day three of our CNA NNOC convention, Year of the Nurse. These past days have been just incredible. Right, Zenny?
Yeah, they really have been, Koki, and I've really enjoyed all the plenaries. I've been so inspired by all of the stories. And what about those moving performances last night in The People Speak? I'm always so proud that these talented actors are willing to give their time to honor nurses in this way.
I know, Zenny, I feel the same. But you know what I can never stop thinking about when I'm on a Zoom call, Zenny?
What's that, Koki?
How many people on the call are probably sitting around in their pajama bottoms or worse?
Koki!
I know. But what are you going to say? I'm a nurse. I'm naturally curious. I want to know things. Seriously, how many people on this convention call right now do you think are wearing their pajama bottoms? Ride or die patient advocate on the top, cozy on the bottom. Can I get people to fess up by using their raise hands function?
Oh, Koki, you are too much, Koki.
I know.
Is it okay if we get back to the convention, please?
Okay, of course. But full disclosure, I have regular clothes on because you never know when I'm going to get up and walk out of the screen, but forget that everybody sees me. But everyone, keep an eye out later for my very important survey of best pajama bottoms to pair with scrub tops.
Oh my goodness, Koki. Okay, everyone. We got a great program planned for all of you today. Next up, I'd like to introduce our CNA, NNOC, and NNU Executive Director, Bonnie Castillo. Bonnie has been at the helm now for more than 2 years, and we cannot think of someone we trust more to be in this position at this time of COVID than her. And you know how the public trusts nurses? Well, we nurses put our faith in Bonnie. Bonnie is the real deal. She's a registered nurse, just like all of us, through and through. Even before this pandemic fully hit, she was already on high alert. And that's because of her nursing background. She really walks the talk and adopted and practiced the precautionary principle early on for our organization. So we were able to stay strong, stay healthy, and keep our union in the best shape possible for the major fights she knew lay ahead. And I also want to mention that Bonnie is Latina and our first executive director of color. So she understands viscerally the deep connection between our work as union nurses and the fight for social justice. So it is our honor, my honor, to introduce CNA, NNOC, and NNU Executive Director, Bonnie Castillo.
Thank you, Zenny, and hello, everyone. I'm so proud and excited to introduce this next panel, Freedom Now, Racial Justice and Solidarity in Our Times. Now, I want you to think for a moment about why did you become a nurse? And of course, there are so many, many reasons, but at the heart of it, we all chose this profession because we wanted to help people. And as nurses, we make a sacred oath to do just that. Help, heal, and advocate for all people. So it is our job to address any harm that comes to our patients inside the walls of the hospital or in our patients' homes or in their communities. This includes the structural racism that is literally killing our Black, Brown, and Indigenous patients. While nurses recognize the social determinants of health and have witnessed the effects of racial discrimination long before this moment, this pandemic makes it even more critical to do the work to end structural racism now. COVID-19 has had a much, much more severe impact on Black, Brown, and Indigenous patients due to their experience of racial discrimination before SARS-CoV-2 even existed. So it is not controversial for nurses to stand up for racial justice. Sometimes people try to tell us to stay in our lane. Well, this is our lane as a natural extension of our role as a humanitarian, caring profession that values life. We have to take a stand in solidarity with our allies, and we must fight harder than ever before against institutionalized racism in healthcare and in our workplaces. We are extremely honored to continue our racial justice education and work today with a panel featuring our incredible CNA NNOC President-elect, Cathy Kennedy, as well as distinguished activists, scholars, and allies, Angela Y. Davis, Ruth Wilson Gilmore, Thenjiwe McHarris. Nurses, you'll hear more about our guests in a minute. And I just want to directly to our panelists, let them know how thankful and honored we are that you all took the time to be here with us during our convention. It really bolsters us in our work, especially this year, as we fight for COVID-19 protections and take part in the massive protests, the uprising for racial justice. It's very timely and a very inspiring moment to be here with you. So thank you. And I also want to extend immense honor and recognition to our moderator, Khadija Kappa, Sutter Division and Northern California Acute Care Director for the California Nurses Association. Khadija has been an instrumental leader in our union, both in collective bargaining and in taking on the issues of racial and social justice. Her perspective and voice are so critical. So with that, I want to introduce Khadija to get the panel started. Welcome, Khadija.
Thank you, Bonnie, and thank you for your leadership in these most critical times. As you said, the struggle for racial justice is at the center of nurses' profession. And as trade unionists, we know we are at our strongest when we understand our fights for workers' rights to be completely intertwined with the struggle for racial justice. When we think about racial justice, we think of it in terms that have been set by powerful movements across the centuries and across the world. These historic struggles against racism have not only been about resisting and surviving unjust violence, but have also offered all people some of the richest, most profound, and most revolutionary ideas around freedom, democracy, and what it means to be human. Racial justice is not just about righting wrongs. It is about reorganizing our society on the principles of solidarity and care, a truth that nurses live and breathe every day at the bedside. We're angry, we're tired, but we also mourn the loss that has happened. But we also uphold this truly inspiring and powerful part of our history and our movement and ourselves. We confront very serious challenges in the days ahead, but nurses are fighters. So we move forward with a spirit of hope and the belief that we can win. I am honored and excited to introduce our amazing guest this morning, who will help us think more about the struggle for racial justice and what it takes to win. We don't have a lot of time this morning, so we're going to get right into it with the hopes that we can continue the conversation in some way, shape, or form in the days ahead. But before that, please use the Q&A tab at the bottom of your screen to answer questions, to ask questions, and we'll do our best to get to them. And also, please use the chat box to show love to our guests and one another. You can use our convention app to learn more about our esteemed guests. So let's begin. Through her activism and scholarship over many decades, Dr. Angela Y. Davis has been deeply involved in the movements for social justice around the world. Her work as an educator has always emphasized the importance of building communities of struggle for economic, racial, and gender justice. She is the author of many books and continues to urge her audiences to think seriously about the future possibility of a world without cages and to help forge a 21st century abolitionist movement. Please welcome Angela Y. Davis. Dr. Ruth Wilson Gilmore is the director of the Center for Place, Culture, and Politics at CUNY Graduate Center. Professor Gilmore, who has instructed me to call her Ruthie, is one of the world's leading thinkers on mass incarceration, policing, and movements for social justice. She has worked as an activist and scholar with grassroots coalitions, worker organizations, and social movements nationally and globally. She is the author of the prize-winning book, Golden Gulag, and her new book, Change Everything, will be published early next year. Please welcome Ruthie Gilmore, all the way from Lisbon, Portugal. Thenjiwe McHarris is a leader and strategist for the movement for Black Lives. She has over 15 years of experience in international policy and advocacy work. Thenjiwe leads the organizing team for Blackbird, a movement strategy organization working hand in hand with organizations and coalitions building long-term efforts for justice. Please welcome Thenjiwe McHarris. And our own Cathy Kennedy, President-elect of the California Nurses Association, National Nurses Organizing Committee, and Vice President of National Nurses United. Cathy has been a registered nurse for 40 years and is currently a staff nurse at Kaiser Permanente in Roseville. In 2013, Cathy was appointed as commissioner to the California Healthcare Workforce Policy Commission and has volunteered as a nurse leader representing NNU's Registered Nurse Response Network, which has engaged domestic and global disaster relief missions for more than a dozen years. Please welcome Cathy Kennedy. So now we're gonna get started. Cathy, drawing on your experience as a nurse and leader in our union, can you start us off?
Sure.
All right. We're in a moment where we are fighting for our lives. So how are we and how are our fights for racial justice and to build powerful union against corporate union busting, the authoritarian right, and in the middle of a pandemic linked in 2020. How does confronting structural racism help in our efforts to build strong militant labor movements and strong militant social movements? Cathy.
Well, thank you for that question, Kadisha. Nurses see these issues are linked and intertwined in the hospital and at the bedside every day. Across the country, nurses are witnessing firsthand how corporate agenda, the inhumane policies of the right, and untreated structural racism has turned this pandemic into a humanitarian catastrophe. We know that Black, Latinx, and Indigenous communities have been hit hardest by COVID-19. Why? Because conditions and policies of economic inequality environmental racism that intersect with racial discrimination in ways making Black and Brown people much more vulnerable to exposure and complications caused by this virus. Essential service work has been devalued, putting Black, Brown, and other workers of colors on the front line of this pandemic at higher rates, often without the proper personal protective equipment, PPE, as well as poor access to healthcare. And we know that essential workers who are undocumented often face terrible working conditions, plus the daily threat of the Immigrant and Customs Enforcement, ICE, raids, and other terrible anti-immigrant policies that are coming out of this White House. We know, rather than invest in care, our for-profit health system is set up so that patients with the highest health needs are the least likely to have access to healthcare in this country. Right now, corporate health hospital chains are cutting essential services for medically underserved communities with a disproportionate impact on African-American and Latinx residents. For example, HCA, the nation's largest for-profit hospital system, received $1 billion of federal pandemic bailout just weeks after ending all of our maternal child care services at Regional Medical Center in San Jose, California, which is located in a low-income community. This is not simply callousness. This is how they make profits. So part of this is challenging ourselves and our fellow nurses, not just to see and understand that our work, not as care and compassionate and tolerant people, but as fighters in the long fight for racial justice. And that is to not just change individual attitudes, but to change the priorities of our healthcare system and society as a whole, and to envision that our healthcare system and ourselves are struggling alongside those social movements that are fighting the good fight in the communities where we work. And as nurses, we have to see that these uprisings and actions that occurred this summer, demanding an end to the structural racism and violence that led to the murders of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, and so many others, as a collectively organized public health intervention. And who better than nurses? Who better than our union to be in the thick of these interventions? The work to achieve racial justice and the work to build strong unions are fundamentally linked. And it's as simple as that. The more we remind ourselves of this, the stronger we're going to be. And obviously this moment is going to require all the strength that we can muster. Can we do this? Yes, we can. Thank you.
Yes, we definitely can, Cathy, and I agree with you 100%, and that's why we're having this conversation. Angela, Ruthie, Thenjiwe, would any of you like to add to our thinking about this intersection of struggle that Cathy just spoke to?
Sure, of course. Let me see, am I unmuted?
Yes.
Okay. Well, first of all, let me say what an honor it is to be a part of this convention of the California Nurses Association and the National Nurses Organizing Committee. And this is the year of the nurse, right? And just let me take 2 seconds to say how deeply appreciative I am to nurses all over the country and the world for the work that you do to keep us safe and healthy, and especially for your insistence on social justice, radical resistance, and militant union organizing. Well, first of all, I really don't think I have to add to what Cathy said. Thank you so much for that analysis. But perhaps I can say that the deep structural roots of racism are entrenched in racial capitalism, which Cathy talked about, privatization, the intertwining of racism and capitalism that is that helps to explain why the colonialism and slavery, which constitutes the origin story of the US, why they continue to define the conditions of indigenous and Latinx and Black communities. They're still active in the 21st century. And of course, the ultimate adversary of all labor movements is capitalism. And global capitalism is especially dangerous to our health when health, as Cathy pointed out, is subordinated to the goal of profit, health suffers. So strong, radical labor struggles not only achieve victories for the working class in terms of job security, wages, working conditions, but they educate us regarding the importance of envisioning a society where profit doesn't reign supreme.
Thank you, Angela. Ruthie or Thenjiwe, would you like to add anything to that? All right, so thank you. In these times of crisis, we're very much swept away by the moment, but it is always important to remember history. Angela, maybe you can start us off on this, and of course, others can chime in. How should we think about movement as making history? What lessons from the past should help us understand the present and help us fight for a better future?
Well, of course, no matter what we do, we are never outside of history. And although we tend to think about history as past history, there's also present history and future history. Human beings are always operating at the intersection of past, present, and future. And the present is produced both by past history and by possible futures. So the argument can be made that we find ourselves in this current predicament of attending to the structural and systematic character of racism belatedly. We're doing this a century and a half after we should have recognized it. This happens precisely because of the historical amnesia that is encouraged in this country. The major historical problems we've never adequately dealt with are rooted in settler colonialism and slavery. The consequences of colonialism have never been dealt with. And it's only now that issues like the naming of sports teams with derogatory references to indigenous people are being addressed. And of course, there are those who wonder why COVID-19 has affected people on Navajo and other reservations and indigenous communities to a much greater extent. They wonder why the disproportionate numbers of Latinx and Black people affected by COVID. But of course, what we're now saying is that this reflects the structural racism that characterizes healthcare among people of color. This is how history continues to haunt us. Our struggles for economic, racial, gender justice always reside on a historical continuum. If one looks at the Black Lives Matter struggles that have addressed racist state violence today, these struggles are linked to historical efforts like challenges to the fugitive slave laws and the slave patrols that are forerunners of contemporary police departments. I've been thinking about what seemed to be a spontaneous collective desire to take to the streets to speak out against the police murder of George Floyd at a time when we were also learning about Breonna Taylor and the vigilante murder of Ahmaud Arbery. I've been thinking about what that meant. And it seems to me that we all served as an unwilling audience of a 21st century lynching by the state in Minneapolis last May. And it was as if we were given the opportunity to rise up in protest against all of the lynchings and racist hate violence that have occurred in this country over the last 150 years. And so I think that history was palpably evoked in that terrible scene that concluded with the death of George Floyd. Even those who have never studied the history of racist violence in this country must have realized that if we don't begin now to extricate ourselves from the morass of racism grounded in slavery and colonialism, it will never happen. And of course, it was amazing that more white people than ever before in our history joined this movement against racism. And thanks to young Black Lives Matter activists like Thenjiwe McHarris, who was absolutely extraordinary from the Movement for Black Lives, we are constantly reminded that racism cannot be effectively challenged without also challenging sexism and misogyny. And so this movement began to quickly to reverberate around the world, from South Africa to Brazil and to France, also bringing up the histories of colonialism and slavery that have had an impact on virtually every country in this world. And of course, you know, I could continue to talk about history. You know, those of us who are professors tend to overtalk. So I don't want to take any more time, but I do want to insist on taking seriously the struggles of nurses. I've always been a supporter of the California Nurses Association. I just, you know, want to thank you for your struggles on Medicare, around Medicare for All, and all of the work you do to strengthen the labor movement.
Thank you, Angela, and thank you for that. Would anybody else like to chime in?
I can. It's very hard to follow the Angela Davis, so I'll be very brief. And I also just want to say and echo how deeply humbled and honored I am to be sitting amongst such a powerful group of women who I've followed and are such powerhouses of thought leadership and activism, but also to be in the amongst of so many people, nurses who, since I was young up until this point of my life, when I think about power, when I think about leadership, when I think about love, I think about nurses. And to be amongst an organized force of nurses is the most humbling and powerful thing that I can experience in this moment, particularly to have this conversation. So I'm just so grateful to be here. And just to echo some of what Angela Davis shared, you know, we can't understand the current moment we're in without having an understanding of history. We can't understand what happened to George Floyd if we don't understand the history of lynching. We can't understand police brutality and the role of policing if we don't understand its roots in chattel slavery, nor can we understand the function of prisons and mass incarceration without understanding the function roles it plays to maintain hierarchies of power and capitalism. And so history is so critical, but it's also the history of what's happened to our people, but there's also the history and legacies of resistance. To be in movement, to be in activism, to resist means that we have to study those that came before us. Many of us sit and stand on the shoulders of giants, of people who fought and learned and failed and got back up and fought again, and we learn from them. And so history teaches us every single day if we choose it. It also reminds us is that there is a generation coming after us. And there's a quote that is really important to me by Frantz Fanon. It says, each generation must discover its mission, fulfill it or betray it in relative opacity. And what that means for me is we have to think about what are we leaving behind for future generations? And so what will be our legacy? And so history also reminds us and places us in the present so that we could be understanding of what we want to leave in the future.
Well said. I agree with you, Angela, that history definitely puts us in the present. Last night we had the people speak, you know, the speech by Fannie Lou Hamer was when I listened to that, I just felt that I am, you know, she's speaking in the present. So I definitely agree with you on that. And I agree that nurses are a powerhouse. All right. So our union, in line with what Angela said earlier about the connection of the nurses profession globally, our union talks a lot about nursing being a global profession and that the challenges nurses confront certainly cut across borders. At the same time, we see that the call for racial justice is not just coming from people here in the United States. Ruthie, how best can we understand the fight for racial justice to be an international fight? Can you lead us on that?
I think my feed might be a little unbalanced. I'm sorry.
That's okay. Do you want me to repeat the question?
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, yes.
Yes, okay, great, great. Sorry, just for a moment. First of all, like my powerful co-panelists, I want to thank the Nurses of California, the National Nurses Union, the National Nurses Organizing Committee, and nurses everywhere for being and doing who you are and what you do. Some years ago, when I was trying to figure out what I would do after spending a good deal of my young adulthood going from job to job without any stability, I thought, well, either I'll become a professor or I'll become a nurse. And I have to confess, I took the easier route and I became a professor. But my fallback plan had been, I would like to be a night nurse because I spent a lot of time in hospitals as a young person because I had an extremely ill father. And the people who were the heroes of my world were nurses. And many of those nurses, as is very clear from the membership of this organization, were themselves long distance migrants, whether or not documented, who had come to the United States to do their caring profession so that their families far away could be all right. And that kind of very often gendered work is typical of the displacement that people experience throughout the history of racial capitalism, as my colleague and friend Angela Davis explained to us earlier, that racial capitalism has knit the entire world together through the forces of displacement, colonialism, slavery, and extraction, as well as settler colonialism and land theft. There's a little poem by the great writer Ishmael Reed about history that I think the audience will like. It's just two lines. First line, I'm outside of history. I wish I had some peanuts. It looks hungry there in its cage. Second line, I'm inside history. It's hungrier than I thought. That's where we are, inside history. And the history of internationalism is the history of anti-racist, anti-exploitative, anti-capitalist, gendered class struggle, full stop. And there's nowhere to see it more clearly than in the work of nurses. I have been talking a lot in recent times, in the last several months, with colleagues and comrades in Brazil, in South Africa, here in Europe, and in India. And we are trying to put together an international abolitionist statement that is an invitation for people to think about the kinds of things that we are talking about here today. And a lot of what we're focusing on has everything to do with the conditions under which we can care for and nurture ourselves in the world. Again, organized nurses give us
the image as well as the backbone for that kind of political work. As many people know, and as Angela Davis mentioned, people all over the planet took to the streets in solidarity with George Floyd, in solidarity with Breonna Taylor, in solidarity with Tony McDade, in solidarity with so many people who have died in the United States, and in solidarity with those who died in their own communities, whether they are part of minoritized long distance migrants, or in the case of Brazil, where Black people are the numerical majority, it makes no difference. People are standing up against structural racism, and the problem that we face, in my view, has everything to do with what indigenous writer and scholar and editor Kelly Hayes calls this. We should, if we want to, hate the guy who's running the United States now, but not pretend like the rot is there, rather than the whole thing is rotten and that's what we have to remedy. So Kelly Hayes said that a few days ago, and that is exactly what we have to do, is change everything. And the way to do it is to do it in solidarity with already organized people who have the stretch and the commitment and the courage that the nurses have shown in their everyday work, as well as in the fight to be a strong trade union that makes it possible for people who might not be organized to see themselves as able to organize too. I wanted to say one other thing, if my time isn't getting too thin here, and that is that what we face currently, when we talk about profits and we talk about HCA and we talk about the world, is we are facing organized violence and organized abandonment. So I just wish to reiterate what all of the people who are at this convention know. Organization is the only way, I believe, the only way for us to achieve the liberation that we're fighting to achieve.
Wow, thank you, Ruthie. Would anyone else like to offer a quick thought or two to help us think more about internationalism?
Sure, I can speak up. So, you know, thank you, Ruthie, because, you know, as you know, one of the things that I can recall is, you know, it was really great to hear from our fellow nurses from Global Nurses United and that network, and to think about the time that we spent together where we're nurses all over the world. We have, you know, the common problems, we're drawn together across borders because of our profession and because of our solidarity. And you know, and that is just really, really important for what we're doing. So doing that is so key. I mean, because what's happening here in the United States is no different than what's happening around the world. And it is important for that solidarity so that we can get that justice that we need. And then the other thing that I think about too is, you know, in our organization, we have the RN Response Network. And in 2017, I had the opportunity to volunteer with 50 other nurses. And we traveled with other union brothers and sisters to Puerto Rico in the wake of Hurricane Maria, when we were answering the call for people who really needed our support. And when we got there, the conditions were so horrific. The people that we met needed the basic things, food, water, medications. And they were even beginning to die of diseases like leptospirosis. And, you know, we were just confronted with, you know, that horrific neglect, the racial neglect from the United States government's response, or lack thereof, you know. People told us that they had been waiting for hours, you know, to talk to FEMA. But yet the only signs that they had of FEMA was a flyer that had a 1-800 number and a website. Now, mind you, the electrical grid was down, no way to communicate, nothing. So how in the world were they supposed to do that? So we took the initiative and we acted as the first responders. You know, we took care of the people with the limited supplies that we had. We reached out to them, provided them with what we could, and tried to get them the care that they needed. But we didn't stop there. We didn't stop there. You know, when we came back, we went to Washington, D.C., and as nurses, we raised our voices about our concerns about what we saw in Puerto Rico. You know, and I don't tell the story because of the suffering of the Puerto Rican people or the shameful response of the Trump administration. I believe that it is important that we think that as registered nurses, as trade unionists, as you say, that our first instinct is to always act across the borders, no matter who needs it, we're always there. And I think that this is the reason why we do our work, and it's so important at this moment in time.
Very true, Cathy, and thank you to you and all the nurses who volunteer for INRN. All of you inspire us. Thenjiwe, would you lead us off in thinking a bit more about the hard work of movement building in this moment? We know it takes mass movements to make change. When we turn on the news or look outside or pour into the streets, it seems like we are living in a real movement moment. Talk about the challenges and opportunities confronting us in building movements, not only for racial justice or for workers' power, but for deep social change.
Sure. I think it's a really important question. You know, I do believe this is a powerful moment in history. I do believe we're living in a movement moment. And I believe that for two reasons. One is the current conditions, and two, our response to those conditions. But before going into some of the challenges and opportunities, I'd like to just ground in at least a little bit of my assessment of the current conditions, and then what I think is the beginning of some of our responses. So in terms of the conditions, you know, it's very clear we're living in challenging and scary times. And we're experiencing the convergence of multiple different crises all at the same time. And I'm gonna name just five. One is the clear rise of white supremacy and white nationalism. Two is the continued escalation and rise of corporate power and the ways in which the rich just continue to find ways to get even richer. This is made extremely clear just by looking at the accumulation of wealth that's occurred over the course of this pandemic. Since March, America's billionaires have made between $650 to $700 billion, while tens of millions of people have had to fall for unemployment. You know, the grotesque wealth accumulation in this country, if that is not a crisis, I don't know what is. Three, there's obviously the impact of this pandemic and our government's failure to center the needs of everyday people and how it's devastated and ravaged so many within our community. Four, whether we're looking at the wildfires in California or the hurricanes in the Gulf, we are witnessing the impact of climate change. And of course, five, the escalation of state violence. This includes everything from policing to incarceration. We are talking about a system that has always been designed in a way that produces more violence, ignores the needs of millions of people, and distorts concepts like justice and safety. All of this is a direct result of structural racism, as well as hierarchies of power based on gender and class. So yes, we are living in very intense and scary times, but I do believe with many folks as well that we're also living in times where more can be made possible. There's also opportunities in this moment. There's reasons for hope. I believe that there's more opportunities before us to change this country than ever. So the second reason, as I said earlier, why I believe this is a historic moment, a movement moment, is us. All of us here and around the world and in this country, everyday people who are becoming bolder, who are becoming more courageous, millions of people who are demanding that our society change, going beyond demands that focus just on individual accountability and ones that center the dismantling of systems that cause harm to our people, believing in the possibility that we can change from being a society that is controlled by the wealthy to one that is controlled by the people. So I believe deep in my heart that we are destined to build one of the biggest movements in this country's history, and at some point in the history of the planet. And we are right now in the midst of a multiracial uprising that has unapologetic Black leadership that is just beginning. But in order for us to win, we must grow, we must sharpen, because I want to be clear, everything that I just said about what we could be destined to do is really not secured. The truth is, it's not predestined. It actually requires active participation from many of us. Crisis capitalism will make a market for our misery and our trauma if we are not prepared to fight back. Crisis requires solutions and resolutions, and corporate power, white supremacists are more than ready to try to resolve these crises so they can experience the upside and we can experience the downside. This is why it's so critical that our interventions, the people's interventions, are the ones that resolve the intersecting crises we are all experiencing. So this is a moment, and really what it is, it's a call, it's a cry, it's an invitation to all of us to step into our power. We have no choice but to build a mass movement that is prepared to challenge the bosses, the white supremacists, the corporations, local, state, and federal government, and anybody that is prepared to make profit and build power off of our suffering. We know that working people, that nurses, that everyday people, that my mama, my auntie, my cousin, that everyday people are the ones best positioned to not just meet the needs of our people in this moment, but also demand and win the structural change that our people deserve. So I'll just talk about three core challenges that I see, and also two core opportunities for us to build this powerful mass movement if we're going to win. The first is that we can't confuse popularity for power. We need to win culturally, and winning popularity can be a critical role, but only if it is connected to a power building strategy and a clear vision. Two, our strategies need to focus on now, but it cannot forget about tomorrow. We are often forced into this false dichotomy that we have to focus on immediate needs, or we have to build towards, or we have to focus on long-term structural change. We are not supposed to choose either or. We can hold both, and we must work towards transformative reforms that deal with the immediate needs now, but also help us work towards the structural change that we need to see tomorrow. And last is false solutions. False solutions are the ones that are always force-fed down our throats and offered to us as a way to deal with the issues of the moment. But they're ones that do not actually address suffering. They don't mitigate harm, and they certainly don't contribute to long-term shifts. But what they do is distract the masses of our people from what actual wins actually are, big or small. An example of that we've said since 2014, are body cameras. So lastly, I'm gonna conclude with just the opportunities and the possibilities. More people are demanding that they want more and that they believe it's possible. From police to prisons, more and more people are talking about abolition and defunding. This is critical not only because of the harm of criminalization and incarceration, but the ways in which this country punishes, uses control and domination, and invests in force as opposed to the people impacts every aspect of our society, from the economy to our democracy. And then second is we have an opportunity to not just challenge the state of our democracy, but to actually build radical democracy in our lifetime. This country, even from the very beginning, was based on a lie. Democracy has always been a false promise of this nation, and we have an opportunity to make radical democracy a possibility. And then I'll just say it last with the economy. We keep talking about how much of this is linked to racial capitalism. It is possible, and I believe, for capitalism in the decades to come to be on its last legs. And around the world, many people are they may not be saying the term capitalism, but in every sector, every part corner of this planet, people are done and finished and angry and frustrated with how capitalism has destroyed their lives and the lives of our people. And then lastly, I just want to say a reason for hope is us. You know, anti-Black racism, misogyny, transphobia, classism has destroyed and ripped apart our movement. Divisions based on sectors has ripped apart our movements. We have an opportunity now more than ever to become unified, to become aligned. We have an opportunity to understand what has undermined our unity and build a big, broad mass movement that can hold all of us, from labor to Black movement, to feminist, to trans liberation. I believe our unity has been the most powerful tool that we've never really weaponized, and the time for us to use it is coming.
I couldn't agree with you more, Thenjiwe. And of course, the rest of you who have spent much time thinking through similar critical question when it comes to building movements to win. Would like to add anything?
I would just like to echo what Thenjiwe said about popularity and taking very seriously what kind of challenge that is. Because at the moment, it seems very easy for many people, especially because of how we're disorganized by social media, no less than connected by social media, to confuse popularity with persuasion and persuasion with organizing and organizing with organizing to win. And what came to mind as you were talking, Thenjiwe, is something that Amilcar Cabral said. When he was a student of agronomy and also a student of revolution, he and his comrades did a whole lot of things to prepare for the long revolution in Guinea-Bissau and Cabo Verde. And one of the things that he had done as an agronomist, that is a soil scientist, for those of you who are not familiar with that profession, was to travel a good deal of the entire surface of the country of Guinea-Bissau, talking to people, seeing how their lives were, seeing the various ways in which communities were organized, because they, of course, are not all the same, not in a small country like Guinea-Bissau, and certainly not in a vast country like the United States or Brazil or South Africa or India. And then to think about how it's possible to combine the hot revolution that the PAIGC engaged in, as well as the sort of cultural revolution, to pick up on the point that Thenjiwe was making, the cultural revolution that for that revolutionary party took the form of education, not haranguing people from the front of the room and telling people what to think, but rather the design of entire school books, school manuals and curriculums and the buildings for schools, such that the soldiers who fought the hot war were also some of them trained to be teachers, and they would stay behind in the liberated zones, working with communities there to build a school. This is a place that had 99% illiteracy in 1961, to build a school to teach adults and children literacy, but to use as the materials for literacy kinds of stories and encounters with the world that would build awareness, build consciousness. And so many people here might have heard of Paulo Freire, who was inspired by the work that this revolutionary party did in Guinea-Bissau. That's where a lot of pedagogy of the oppressed came from. But I say all that to lead back up to what Cabral said. When he was studying the techniques of guerrilla warfare, he studied what had been done in Cuba, and he studied what had been done in Vietnam. And in both of those places, mountains played an enormously important tactical role in the success of the revolutionary armed forces. Guinea-Bissau does not have any mountains. It's mangroves, it's quite a flat place, basically an archipelago with a lot of water. So Cabral said, well, then the people have to be the mountains. The people have to be the mountains. And I think that that's what we do, what nurses do, by helping people return to health and be strong, they make the people mountains. What unions do is build mountains so that when a lever of power that we recognize is up there on the ceiling, we don't wait until the tallest guy in town comes in to reach it for us. The people are the mountains, and we lift one another up to reach the lever. So I think that these images help us make very specific the kinds of impassioned analysis that Thenjiwe has shared with us, and give us some understanding of the crucial relationship of history, which is present, and the kind of stretch of organization and individual experience that Cathy has shared with us to understand where we are today. We can't win without each other. We will lose without each other. And the fact is that behind the sturdy curtain of racism, of white supremacy, of white separatism, the legacies of slavery and settler colonialism, we also know that the police kill with impunity 2,000 white people every year. I mean, we've got this big potential movement that would be everybody, just about, except for the plutocrats at the top. So thank you.
Thank you, Ruthie. We definitely can win in solidarity and unity. Would anybody else like to chime in on this? All right, so we can definitely see and feel the winds of change blowing. Taking it from here, we know that we can't change the world by just changing minds. We also need to change social, political, and economic conditions. Angela, if you can talk about how defeating the right and abolition democracy fits into this.
Well, of course we have to change minds. First, let me thank Thenjiwe and Ruthie and Cathy for their amazing interventions. I'd like to listen to this again. I hope it's available. of course, we do have to change minds, change consciousness. I like to go back to what the philosopher Hegel said, that history is progress in the consciousness of freedom. And I think that particularly at this moment, we are developing the kind of mass consciousness that needs to be translated into a change in material conditions. And as Thenjiwe pointed out, it's not given. The changing the consciousness is not enough. As Ruthie pointed out, popularity is not going to move us in the direction that we see is possible at this moment. And this will only happen if people do the difficult behind the scenes, unglamorous work of transforming structures and institutions. And in this context, of course, Medicare for All is a pivotal structural transformation in healthcare. And I deeply appreciate the fact that the Nurses Union has taken the lead in supporting this structural change. But everywhere, in education, in culture, as a matter of fact, even within the jazz community, there's a conversation now about the need to begin to transform or jazz audiences that are practically all white, although of course jazz is a product of Black people and most of the players are Black, most of the administrators are white. So we're beginning to think about what can be done now in order to translate some of the consciousness that has emerged into actual change so that we can see the possibility of toppling racial capitalism in our lifetime. But I just want to point out that it's usually women who do that work and have always done the work that, the behind the scenes work, the work that really matters. It's people who are not necessarily up front. They don't get the attention. They aren't the limelight. They're not in the limelight. They are the ones who do the work that really will make a difference. And so I want to just do a shout out to organizers and people who do, you know, all of the that work that render movements possible. Those of us who may serve as the face of the movement are not the ones who are the most important actors here. You know, we're only standing in for the masses of people that do the work. But I do want to say that this is a really exciting moment. I never thought that I would see the possibility of abolition in my lifetime. I always imagined it as, you know, being, you know, many, many, many decades in the future. And suddenly we have this historical conjuncture that makes it possible for vast numbers of people to shift in the way they think about racism to begin. I mean, how many times have you heard media people talk about systemic racism or structural racism? We never expected that. But the problem is we have to seize this moment. If we don't seize this moment, it will slip away from us. And that work continues to need to be done. And I'd like, again, to thank the Nurses Association for reminding us that Medicare for All is key to these struggles.
Thank you, Angela. We're definitely seizing the moment here. Cathy, as a nurse and advocate for Medicare for All, how does the fight fit into this?
Well, first let me say thank you to these wonderful, powerful women that have been on this panel and you're inspiring me. I admire you all. I'm in awe, so I'm just really honored to do that. And as it relates to Medicare for All, you know, we know that the denial of healthcare comes with for-profit health system that hits hardest on communities of color and their lack of access to healthcare when needed. We know that. So when we talk about changing those priorities, these are the stakes. So therefore, we don't stop saying everyone deserves healthcare. We fight for Medicare for All until everybody is in. And through that fight, we begin to develop the leaders, build connections, alliances, and movements that involve people like Ruthie and Thenjiwe and Angela have spoken about. People, lots of people, a mass movement of working people that make all of our fights that much stronger. Less strangulation, hold on our economy and the fleecing by the healthcare corporates, which means potentially more resources for the social good. Workers who are fighting to join the union or who are already part of the union are freed up to, you know, make stronger demands on the bosses and to build, you know, that power. And it's so important for workers of color. This also means healthier activists, community members, fighting for racial justice and housing, education, environment, the defunding of the police, and an overall reshaping of our community, our society, where care and solidarity always come first. So Medicare for All means less suffering, less trauma, less illness and death for all communities. And this isn't a small thing. It's not a silver bullet and it's not a real quick fix, as we all have been saying, what you've been hearing, but it's significant and it's a solid step in reorganizing our society for the common good. And I believe it is a powerful contribution to the unfinished business of racial justice. So we've got a lot of work to do, ladies, and you know it's going to take women. So I'm ready.
So am I, Cathy. So am I. Thenjiwe, nurses have engaged in racial justice fights at their hospitals and communities. How does the vision for Black Lives fit into this?
Sure. And for those that don't know the vision for Black Lives, the vision for Black Lives is and was a national platform that was created by the Movement for Black Lives. And it's called Vision for Black Lives, a national platform and policy demands for Black power. And you can go to m4bl.org to take a look at it. But I just want to say two things about the vision. Both the outcome of it was about in a moment, particularly throughout the course of 2015, 2016, where the country was talking about police brutality. It was an opportunity for us to assert and demand the end to the war on Black people, but also an end to economic violence, an end to patriarchal violence, really expanding people's understanding of what violence is in this country, and then asserting demands that spoke for at least this part of our movement, the Movement for Black Lives. But the piece I want to talk about is really the process. You know, the Vision for Black Lives took a year, and it took a year of not just easy dialogue and discussion. It was a year of political struggle, of debate, of studying both our current conditions, what is happening to our people, but also what are we going to put forward in terms of shared demands to resolve both the immediate, but how to work towards some of the long-term structural transformative change that we all talk about. It was also an opportunity for us to talk about what is liberation, to not just like use the word, but really like break it down. What's liberation? What's power? Like, what is power to us? Like, do we have a shared definition of power? Do we have a shared definition of what it means to be part of a movement? Can we define movement together? And so the Vision for Black Lives, the way I like to call it, is an imperfect evolving document that is a tool and birthed and a product of internal political struggle. And really what I hope is a model for us within Black movement and perhaps even other movements to continue to struggle internally so that we understand sort of what are our shared demands in our shared collective vision. And you know, my wildest vision, I'm just, you know, very inspired by Angela Davis's, when she talked about seizing the opportunity, because I think I go to sleep and I wake up thinking about what are the opportunities that we have not yet seized that I will be thinking about for the rest of my life. and I think one of them is, what does it look like to build a broad mass movement? And for me, what it looks like is people being willing to fight together. But if you're willing to fight together, we have to understand each other. We have to understand what we're collectively up against. And I really dream one day that movements of movements can put together a vision for the future that really articulates what are we demanding in terms of economic justice? What are we demanding in terms of political power? But also when we talk about an alternative for this country and the world, can we be aligned and articulate a shared vision of what that is so that we could be willing to fight for it together?
Thank you, Thenjiwe. Ruthie, can you help us think about how the demand across the country to defund police fits into this discussion?
Sure, I'd be happy to. And once again, because we're getting close to our end, I want to thank the nurses for asking me to participate in this amazing plenary, and thank my sisters for being as you are, which is endlessly truthful and inspiring and humble at the same time. Defund the police. Many people take to be an attack on the individual income of individual people, most of whom haven't killed anybody extra legally. Well, this clearly does not jive with what we've been talking about all of this, all of our plenary, concerning how we advance our ability to take care of ourselves and each other and to flourish in the world, not just survive, but flourish. So perhaps it would help people to think about this. Tax struggle, the struggle over taxes, who pays what to whom and for what, tax struggle is the oldest form of class struggle. Even before there was capitalism, tax struggle was class struggle. And what we see today, when we put on the one hand the enormous budgets available for policing, not only the uniform police and all of their equipment, but all of the police jobs that are embedded in all of our institutions, whether it's social work or nursing or education. We all have to do trainings at the beginning of the year, we who are academics, and we're told we have to take a test that shows that we have become good, non-badge wearing police. We're told about who we have to turn in and why. So policing is everywhere, as well as school resource officers and so forth. On the other hand, Medicare for All would be straight out of the same budget. The tax dollars that should be flowing in from those most able to pay and redistributed to everybody who needs to have Medicare and other protections from calamity and opportunities for advancement. The struggle over budgets, therefore, is not merely a struggle over a dollar here or a dollar there. The struggle over budgets, whether it's a local budget, municipal, county, state, federal, or the budget for the United Nations or some transnational association, is a struggle over priorities. The struggle over budgets gives us a view into who is able to grasp those levers of power I was talking about earlier. That, therefore, is class struggle. And I want to tell a little bit of a story. 20 years ago, a number of us in California had been fighting for already then more than a year to stop the state of California from building its 24th new mega prison in Delano. And what we did, because we were just a tiny handful of people, like six abolitionists, basically in critical resistance and California prison moratorium project, what we did was we did outreach to already organized people, the United Farm Workers, to the SEIU, Public Sector Workers, Local 1000 of the California State Employees Association, and others, and the nurses. And the nurses were the ones who didn't miss a beat. They understood that the struggle against that prison was a struggle over priorities, was a struggle about the future that we want as against the future that was being built for us. And they lined up with us against the California Correctional Peace Officers Association, which is a very powerful union in the state of California. That moment, which we didn't maintain for a very long time, was one where we got a glimpse of where we are today. We had a glimpse 20 years ago of where we are today. We had no idea there would be a pandemic. We had no idea that the catastrophes of climate change, of fires, of racial capitalism predating on the world was going to bring people out into the streets the way people have come out into the streets. But the moment was very clear for us, abolitionists on the ground, that we could and should and must learn, look to the nurses, to think about building a strong movement in California, not only against that prison, but everything the prison represents, and a strong movement internationally, because we realize that we cannot destroy racial capitalism, which is all capitalism, in one country. We have to do this internationally, even though we must work locally, however we define locally, to achieve it. So defund the police is a way for people to go through the kind of process that Thenjiwe was talking about and think very hard about where budgets come from, where dollars come from, where they should come from, and where they should go.
All right. Thank you, Ruthie, for that clear explanation of what we've been hearing across the country, and something that our union have, continued to champion, which, our nurses understand that more need to be more money needs to be distributed. And so this is a great way to explain that. So thank you for that. I think we have enough time for one question. So I'm gonna take a question from Chessie Garcia. And this is the question, ladies. Any words of advice for all of us novice nurses in the pathway towards activism and toward hope? Any of you can take that. Go ahead, Miss Angela.
Well, what is the pathway? I think there are many pathways. I don't think that there is a map and a single set of strategies that are going to move us forward. I think that we create arenas for struggle wherever we are. And they can be produced in at our workplaces, they can be produced through cultural struggle. I say this because people often assume that they have to be in a particular place. They have to be within a particular movement or demonstration in order to call themselves participants in this movement for change. And of course, we want everybody to come out into the streets when there is a call. But demonstrations are demonstrations of the existence of movements. And the process of movement building involves looking very closely at what is possible in the context of where one happens to be. And of course, nurses are in a very critical location at this moment, at this conjuncture of the pandemic and the awareness of the structural character of racism and how that impacts healthcare, how that impacts policing, how that impacts incarceration. And so I think the most important way to think about this question is to ask what can I do? How can I create new arenas of struggle? What can I do that perhaps has not been done before? I don't think there, as I said, I don't think there are any maps. I think we follow any direct guidelines. You know, although organizing is a skill, and I don't want to discount that. But I do think creativity is important, and the involvement of artists and musicians who often allow us to feel what we cannot, what we have not yet learned how to say. And so I would urge the person asking the question to be creative and to come up with, you know, new ways of encouraging people to get involved in struggle. Of course, it's going to be the youth who are in the leadership. And this is so clear listening to someone like Thenjiwe, whom I've been watching for many years now. And I'm totally impressed by her development and the extraordinary leadership she is providing.
Thank you, Angela. So they're telling me to wrap up because we're over time. Perhaps we can leave on that high note. However, I invite the nurses that are listening to think about this as the beginning of our conversation and urge you all to join me in working hard to create many spaces for these important questions in the days ahead. I want to thank our panelists, Angela Davis, Ruthie Gilmore, Thenjiwe McHarris, and our own Cathy Kennedy. It is an honor to hear from and be in dialogue about these absolute urgent issues. I hope everyone learned a lot and feels better prepared for our work to win racial justice. I thank you.